Praise the Lord. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the faithfulness of your people. Thank you for gathering us together. Thank you that at such a time like this, your servants, Christian workers, can come together to learn of you and to know the important, urgent thing we're expecting now, and then to double our efforts and to do everything we need to do in preparation for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're praying, Lord, that none of us here will come in vain today in Jesus' name. We're praying, Lord, that you'll stir up your people, revive us. We pray, Lord, that the fire of the Holy Ghost will burn in every heart. And Lord, you put springs under our feet that will run, will not be weary, will walk, will not faint, and will do your work with renewed power, zeal, passion, every day in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. Consider, we're coming to Matthew chapter 24, and we're reading from verse 3. Matthew chapter 24, verse 3. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, "Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world?" The Lord Jesus had been teaching his own disciples, teaching the church, teaching us that his coming is certain. He's come the first time. He came to sacrifice, and he came to pay the price of our salvation. And as we come to the Lord, one by one, born again, saved, children of God, will become the church, the people of God, the assembly of the saints. And then he tells us he's coming again. And the disciples wanted to know, are there signs to expect? Are there things that will be in evidence at the time Christ will come? And he assured them that definitely he'll be coming. And these are the signs that we'll see at the time of his coming. It's this we're thinking about, talking about, meditating on today. Understanding the profound prophecies of Christ's second coming. The prophecies are profound, they're deep, and they have far-reaching implications for every believer, for the sinners in the world, as well as for the church. And as profound as they are, the Spirit of God can give us understanding, and that understanding will make us to have the right focus and do the work is giving us to do, because we know his coming will be sudden, his coming will be unannounced. And he said over and over that many people will not be ready, they'll not be prepared at the time of his coming. That's the reason why we need, as individuals, as workers, as a church, to understand the prophecies of his coming. In Matthew chapter 26, verse 64, it tells us, Jesus says unto him that was said, "Nevertheless, I say unto you, hereafter shall you see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven." You understand? He was before the high priest. They were going to crucify him. He was going to die. He will rise again. Then he says, after all this had happened, he'll come again, because we'll see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand, on the right hand of power and glory. And he'll be coming in the clouds of heaven. He tells us then that coming is certain, is definite, that it's not the first coming. It's come already the first time. And it's going to pay the price for salvation that first time. But then he'll come again. Acts chapter 1, reading from verse 9. He had risen from the dead now, and the disciples had seen him 40 days with infallible proof that this is the Christ risen from the dead. Now he was going up. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. He's completed all the events of his first coming, and now he's taken up into heaven. Then in verse 10, we're told, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men, actually angels appearing as men, stood by them in white apparel. Verse 11, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, not another one, the one that came the first time, and the one that paid the price of our salvation, the one that became our Savior, our Lord, our Redeemer, the substitute, the perfect sacrifice, this same Jesus, the one that rose from the dead, and the one that is going to heaven right now, this same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner physically as we have seen him bodily taken up, physically taken up before your eyes, and goes to heaven. In the same way, in the same manner, as ye have seen him go into heaven, he'll come again. And then as we come to Revelation chapter 1, the last of the books of the New Testament and of the Bible, what he has said from the beginning of the New Testament, that he will come again, from Matthew. And he continues now. He tells us at the end of the New Testament, Revelation chapter 1 verse 7. Behold, he cometh with the clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. And then we're told in verse 8, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, says the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. The Lord is coming again. Tonight, we're looking at the message, understanding the profound prophecies of Christ's second coming. Three things we're looking at in the message. Number one, the period of perplexity before his second coming. What shall be the signs of thy coming? What are the things that will be happening just before the coming of the Lord? The period of perplexity before his second coming. Number two, the prediction and prophecy of his second coming. Prediction, something not happened yet is going to happen. And then by the spirit of revelation, the Lord reveals to his people and predicts that this is what will happen. That's how the first coming was predicted and prophesied about. And all that the Old Testament said in prediction, in prophecy, that Christ will come. All those things were fulfilled to the letter. Now that we have seen the fulfillment of the revelation of his first coming, the second coming now is at hand. And we can see and read all the predictions and prophecies of Christ's second coming. As the word of God can be broken, and his truth cannot be denied, that prediction, that prophecy of his coming will definitely be fulfilled. And I pray all of us will have the benefit in the fulfillment in Jesus' name. The prediction and prophecy of his second coming. Number three, the priority of preparedness for his sudden coming. The date is not known, the time is not known, but he'll come suddenly when most of the people of the world are not even aware. That's the reason why, because we don't know the time, the day, or the time of the day it will happen. That's the reason why we need to be well prepared. And that ought to be our priority, the priority of preparedness for his sudden coming. Let's come to number one. Number one, the period of perplexity before his second coming. We're looking at Luke chapter 21, verse 25. And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Verse 26 says, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Verse 27, and then shall this the Son of Man come in a cloud with power and great glory. When it says and then, in verse 25 it talks about the perplexity, and then it talks about distress of nations, and it talks about men's hearts failing them because of the perplexities and the trouble and the terrible things they'll be seeing just before the coming of the Lord. And then he says, and then, after those perplexities, shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Verse 28, and when these things begin to come to pass, when all those things perplexing, all those things traumatic, all those things that trouble the hearts and the minds of people in the world, when they begin to happen, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth near. The period of perplexity before his second coming. We're looking at three things. In number one, the prevailing perplexities before his second coming. Number two, the perilous perversions in soaring, increasing, escalating corruption. Number three, the pointless preoccupations before his coming. Look at number one, the prevailing perplexities before his second coming. Already we read Luke chapter 21. Let's look at just verse 25 now. In verse 25, it says, there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations there shall be. It wasn't there at the time when Christ was talking, but looking at the coming of the Lord and the events that will come before the coming of the Lord, it says there shall be distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Isaiah chapter 22 verse 5. In Isaiah chapter 22 verse 5, for it is a day of trouble, a period of trouble, and treading down, and of perplexity by the Lord God of hosts in the valley of vision, breaking down the walls, and of crying to the mountains. That is the people of the world looking for a place of escape and looking for an avenue of escape. They'll be crying to the mountains to fall on them. They'll be so perplexed. They'll be so confused. They'll be so much in distress. They'll not know what to do. Those are the things that will precede the coming of the Lord. Micah chapter 7, reading from verse 2. In Micah chapter 7 verse 2, the good man is perished out of the earth, and there is none upright among them. They all lie in wait for blood. They hunt every man his brother with a net. There'll be no trust. There'll be no good relationship. People will be thinking of and fighting for their own personal isolated rights, that they will forget the care, the need of other people. They'll be untrustworthy. In verse 3, it says that they may do evil with both hands earnestly. Before the coming of the Lord, there'll be so much evil, so much sin in the world, so much transgression, and so much iniquity. It will be like they're doing evil, they're committing sin, they're having transgression with both hands with earnestness. The prince asketh, and the judge asketh for reward, and the great man, he uttereth his mischievous desire. So wrap it up. Then in verse 4, it tells us the best of them, the best of people not saved, not giving themselves to the Lord, and the best of the people that you will find in any area, every section of society, because of the prevailing iniquity at such a time, before the coming of the Lord, the best of them is a briar. The most upright is sharper than a thorn edge. The day of thy watchmen and the visitation cometh, now shall be their perplexity. Period of perplexity at the time of the coming of the Lord. Matthew chapter 24, reading from verse 4. Jesus answered and said unto them, here is the Lord Jesus answering their question about when shall these things be, verse 3, and what shall be the signs of thy coming, and then the signs of the end of the world. And there is the answer of the Lord Jesus now, and Jesus answered and said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. Verse 5. It says, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. In verse 6. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things shall come to pass. They will happen before the coming of the Lord, but the end is not yet. Then in verse 7, it says, for nation shall rise against nation. That's what causes the perplexity, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse and different places. Verse 8, all these, the trauma, the pestilence, the trials, the oppression, the affliction, the wars, the commotions, all those distresses of nations, they are the beginning of sorrows. The prevailing perplexities before his second coming. Number 2, the perilous perversions in soaring corruption. Corruption will escalate. Corruption will spread everywhere. Corruption will be in the West as well as in the developing countries, literally everywhere. Perilous perversions in soaring corruption. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, we're reading from verse 1. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. This know also, that in the last days, that is, in the days preceding the coming of the Lord, in the last days, perilous time shall come. Look at verse 2. It says, for men shall be lovers of their own self. Adamic nature and self-centeredness will be pronounced in the hearts, in the minds of people all over the world. Men shall be lovers of their own selves. Remember, these are the signs preceding the coming of the Lord. Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. Holiness of heart will not be popular. Holiness of life will not be popular. Not even among religious people. They'll be ungrateful, unthankful, unholy. Verse 3. In verse 3, without natural affection. Truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, people be violent, and they will not care for the life, for the protection, for the security of other people. They will be violent and fierce, despisers of those good. In verse 4, it says, traitors, heady. To be heady means to be stubborn. To be heady means to be rigid, incorrigible. To be heady means that people will just want to have their way. It's one of the signs of the times preceding the coming of the Lord. Lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Verse 5, having a form of godliness, they have superficial religion that doesn't take in salvation and doesn't have the evidence of being born again, but is still the religious all the same, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. From such, turn away. 2 Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 4, reading from verse 1. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Now, the Spirit speaketh expressly, clearly, plainly, pointedly, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith. Those who had been in the faith before, they were born again. And Jesus said so, that because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. They will deny the convictions of the past, the consecration of the past, and the Christian character of the past. Many will turn away from the Lord. In the latter times, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits, that is, evil spirits, seducing spirits, lying spirits, deceptive spirits, will cover the land, saturate the land, and come to people and deceive them, and they will buy into the deception. It says, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And then we're told in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, reading from verse 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. Let no man deceive you. The time preceding the coming of the Lord will be a time of deception, terrible deception. And so the Spirit says through Paul the apostle to the church, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first. There come a falling away first. Before the coming of the Lord, whole assemblies, whole churches, whole denominations will fall away from what they used to believe and from what they used to emphasize. And the Spirit of God says, let no man deceive you by any means. For that day is referring to the day of the coming of the Lord shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin, the Antichrist, be revealed, the son of perdition. In verse 4, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God. That's unimaginable. That a religious man, a religious figure, will be so saturated and infiltrated by Satan that he will oppose and exalt himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God seated in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. And then in verse 5, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? Those are the times. The Lord, the time, the period preceding the time of the coming of the Lord. And then in verse 6, and now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. Verse 7, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth, hinders, prevents, will let, will hinder, will prevent, until he be taken out of the way. That is the church that restricts and limits the coming of the full force of the Antichrist. The church is still here worldwide. And it is the church that limits, that hinders the full overflowing force of the mystery of iniquity by the Antichrist. And then he'll be taken out of the way at the time of the rapture. And then will the Antichrist, with all the fury of the wrath of Satan, and the wrath of God too, will come upon the world. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way. Then in verse 8, it says, and then shall that wicked, capital W there, that's the Antichrist, be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Verse 9, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. That's the terrible thing that will be happening just before the appearance of the coming of the Lord. Verse 10, it says, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. Verse 11, and for this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie. Verse 12, that they all, without exception, those who believe lies, that they all, those who believe false doctrine, that they all, those who are swept away with the mystery of iniquity, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but add pleasure in unrighteousness. Jude chapter 1 verse 14. Jude 1 verse 14. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of this, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints. Verse 15, to execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all the ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Verse 16, these are murmurers that will be very common near the time of the coming of Christ. Murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lusts, and their mouth speaketh great swelling words, have amazed persons in admiration because of advantage. Let's come to number three here. In number three, the pointless preoccupations before his second coming. There'll be many people that be preoccupied with many, many things. Things useless, things unprofitable, and things that will not ensure their future and confirm their coming, their going with the Lord when he comes. And yet they would leave the important thing of being ready and being prepared for the coming of the Lord. They'll be pursuing things that will not favor them at the time of the coming of the Lord. The pointless preoccupations before his second coming. Matthew chapter 24, we're reading from verse 36. In Matthew 24, verse 36, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. No man, no prophet, no preacher, no evangelist, no writer, no author knows the date of his coming. And so if anyone is reading a book and it sets a date, this is the time the Lord will come, and he said they have seen the revelation and a great vision, is the lie of the devil. Because Jesus himself said, of that day and that hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Then in verse 37, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Noah spoke about the flood coming. They didn't believe. He preached about the time the flood will come. They didn't believe. He told them of the condition that would be necessary. The condition of reconciling with God and walking with God in righteousness every day of their lives, because they didn't know when the flood was come. Yet they were and so Jesus said, as the days of Noah were, days of preaching, days of building the ark, days of preparation, so that he and his family and everyone that will, so that all that will believe, if they will believe, they will come into the ark of safety. But they did not. And Jesus said, as it was at that time, so it shall be at the coming of the Son of Man. Verse 38, it says, for as the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. In verse 39, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away. All those unbelievers, all the careless ones, all the unprepared ones, all the unbelieving ones, all the people that will not get ready and come into the ark of safety, took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. I pray you'll be ready. I said I pray you'll be ready. Luke chapter 17, verse 28. In Luke chapter 17, verse 28, Likewise also, as it was in the days of Lord, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded, just been preoccupied about a lot of things except preparing for eternity. They thought everything was asleep, and they were preoccupied with earthly activities, but eternity, they were ignorant about that. Likewise also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. Verse 29. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Verse 30. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. Verse 32. It says, remember Lord's wife. The Lord has pointed out very clearly that he's coming. And then he tells us the period, the time preceding his coming. Come to point number two. Point number two, the prediction and prophecy of his second coming. The prediction and the prophecy of his second coming. As you think about the coming of the Lord, there are two parts. Part one is coming for the church. Is coming for the saints. That's the rapture. And then there's a period of 7 years of the tribulation, the great tribulation. And then is coming with the saints to judge the earth. Look at John chapter 14. In John chapter 14, is the coming, the return, is the rapture. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In verse 2, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. In verse 3, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Not to judge you, but to take you away from earth before the great tribulation. I will come again and receive you to myself. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Then in Acts chapter 1, verse 11, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Three things we're looking at here. Number one, the foundational predictions of his second coming. The prediction at the very foundation, the foundation of revelation, the foundation of the prophecy that Christ, who came first, sacrificed, paid the whole price for everyone's salvation, went to heaven, that he'll come again, the foundational predictions of his second coming. Number two, the firm promise of his second coming. Promise as firm as God himself, that this cannot be broken, that this is definite and this is sure. A firm promise the Lord had given of his second coming. Number three, the final prophecies of his second coming. Look at number one. The foundational predictions of his second coming. Matthew chapter 16, looking at verse 27. Matthew 16, verse 27. For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then shall he reward every man according to his works. Foundational. Christ had not even ended all the events of the first coming, and yet he assured his disciples, assured the believers, assured the church that he will die, he'll be buried, he'll rise again, he'll go to heaven, and then he will return. He said that at the foundation of the revelation that he gave about his coming. And chapter 24, reading from verse 30. Matthew chapter 24, verse 30. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. He's talking about his coming after the time of the great tribulation, that the Lord himself will come, and when he comes, the earth shall mourn, all the tribes of the earth. They shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. Verse 31. In verse 31, and he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect with the, from the four winds and from one end of heaven to the other. Look at verse 35 there. In verse 35, heaven and earth, he says, shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Heaven and earth passing away, and yet he says, my words, every word he spoke about his coming, every word he spoke about his appearing, every word he spoke about the certainty of the coming of the Lord, he said, the heaven and the earth will pass away, but his word shall not pass away. In Luke chapter 21, reading from verse 27. Luke chapter 1, chapter 21, verse 27. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Have you noticed how many times the Lord himself mentioned is coming. Not just once or twice, but over and over. If he said it only once, the truth personified. And if he said it two times, three times, you must understand the certainty of the coming of the Lord. He'll come in a cloud with power and great glory. Verse 36, it says in verse 36, it tells us, watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. Tells us in Mark chapter 13, reading from verse 35. Mark chapter 13, verse 35. Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh. As for his coming, definite. As for his coming, settled. As for his coming, certain. But he said, you watch. Don't take it for granted. I'm saved. I must be ready. I'm sanctified. I'm ready. I'm a part of the bride of Christ. Why am I not ready? I'm ready. But he says, watch. Watch ye therefore. For ye know not when the master of the house cometh. At evening, you know not. At midnight, you know not. At the crowing, you know not. Or in the morning, you know not. He says in verse 36, lest coming suddenly. He'll come unannounced. He'll come suddenly. But he's sure to come. Only you don't know morning, noon, evening, or night, but definitely he will come. Lest coming suddenly, he find you sleeping. Verse 37, watch, I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. Number two, if the firm promise of his second coming. Firm promise of his second coming. In Luke chapter 12, verse 35. Luke chapter 12, verse 35. Let your loins be girded about, and your lights burning. Verse 36, and ye yourselves like unto men that wait for their Lord. Men having the mind, the heart, the expectation, the preparedness, the readiness, as men waiting for their Lord. When he will return from the wedding, that when he cometh and knocketh, they may open unto him immediately. Then verse 37, blessed are those servants whom the Lord, when he cometh, shall find watching. Verily I say unto you, that he shall gird himself and make them to sit down to meat, and will come forth and serve them. Verse 38. And if he shall come in the second watch, or come in the third watch, and find them so, blessed are those servants. Second Thessalonians chapter 1, reading from verse 7. Second Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7. And to you who are troubled, tried, tempted, suffering, and to you who are troubled by all the things happening around us in the world, and to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven. You see, all the parts of the New Testament reaffirming and re-emphasizing that Christ is coming. In the Gospels, is emphasized, is coming again. In the Acts of the Apostles, is emphasized, is coming again. In the Epistles and then in Revelation, is revealed, he will come. There should be no doubt in your heart. And he says to you who are troubled, rest with us. When the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels, then in verse 8, in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God, the people who are not saved, the people who do not have the gospel, the people who heard the gospel but did not surrender, did not submit, did not yield themselves to the gospel, the Lord will take vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 9, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Then verse 10, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints. When the Lord comes, perdition, punishment, recompense, retribution will come on the sinners, the people that heard the gospel but did not accept the gospel, did not receive the gospel, did not surrender, submit to the gospel. But then for the saints who yielded to the Lord Christ will be glorified in his saints and to be admired in all them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day. What's Paul the Apostle saying? Those who benefited from the events of the first coming. In the first coming, he provided salvation, and these people submitted to the benefits of salvation. In the first coming, he provided sanctification, holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. And these people benefited from that sacrifice that sanctifies us. In the first coming, he did everything for our redemption, and they came to the Lord, and they benefited from the redemption he provided at the first coming. Now, in the second coming, he'll be glorified in them. But the people who do not receive the profit and the benefit, the salvation, the reconciliation, the redemption of the first coming will not have part in the benefit of the second coming, when it shall come to be glorified in his saints and to be admired in all them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day. The firm promise of his second coming. Number three is the final prophecies of his second coming. In the book of Revelation, as a final book, he gives us the assurance, the affirmation of the fact that he is coming again. And you see, after you have written, after he has given us the book of Revelation, the final book, there is nothing that can come after that final book to contradict what the final prophecies have already uttered and affirmed. Revelation chapter 1 verse 7, the final prophecies of his second coming. Behold, he cometh with the clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. You lost your amen there. Revelation chapter 3 verse 11. In Revelation chapter 3 verse 11, behold, I come quickly. I come quickly. This is Christ in heaven. This is Christ the glorified. This is Christ on the right hand of majesty on high. And he announces from heaven and he says, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast. What do you have? Salvation, sanctification, the power of the Holy Ghost. What do you have? Conviction. What do you have? The doctrines of the Bible. What do you have? Everything you receive from Christ that made you a saint of God, a child of God. What do you have? The Spirit, stabilizing Spirit, comforting Spirit that makes you steadfast, and you know that the time of the Lord is very near, and because of that you are firm in your conviction. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Then he tells us in chapter 16, Revelation chapter 16, verse 15, behold, I come as a thief. That means he's coming when many people will not be aware, unnoticed, unannounced, suddenly. He says, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments. Talking about the garment of salvation. As we move around, the people that will try to splash mud, dirt on your white garment of righteousness, you need to watch. There are conversations, there are communities. There's the corruption of the world that has tried to soil your garment of salvation, righteousness, and then you'll not be ready. But he says, behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watches and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and see his shame. Chapter 22 of Revelation, reading from verse 7. Behold, I come quickly. Have you noticed how Jesus repeated, I come quickly, I come quickly? Oh, but you see, he said that 2,000 years ago, and he has not come. You don't remember? 1,000 years of the Lord is like one day. And when he says, I come quickly, I come soon, I come certainly. Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. It's not enough to say, I am saved. Are you keeping to the prophecies, to the pronouncements, to the precepts, to the commandments, to the word of the Lord in this book? Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. Verse 12. Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. He looks at our work. How sanctified? in the heart when we render that work, how honest, how looking and centering our affection on the glory of the Lord in everything that we do. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. Verse 20, it says, he who testifies these things says, surely I come quickly. And the church said, amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Let's come to point number three now. The priority of preparedness for a sudden coming. Your priority, my priority of readiness, of preparedness for a sudden coming. Mark chapter 13, reading from verse 32. Mark chapter 13, verse 32. But of that day and that hour knoweth no man. No, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father. Verse 33. Take ye heed, watch and pray. For ye know not when the time is. Verse 34. For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, and to every man his work, and to every man his work, and to every minister, and to every worker, and to every servant, and to every brother, every sister, and to every son, every daughter, everyone his work, and gave authority to his servants, and to every man his work, and commanded the potter to watch. Verse 35. In verse 35, watch ye therefore, servants of God, watch ye therefore, workers for the kingdom, watch ye therefore, sons and daughters in the vineyard of the Lord, watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at evening, at midnight, or at cock crowing, or in the morning. Verse 36, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. And then in verse 37, what I say unto you of the first generation, I say unto all of all generations. What I say unto you, my immediate apostles, I say to all the members and all the ministers of the church until the end of time, I say unto all. What I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. Three things we're looking at. Number one, personal perception of his return. You don't take it just as a general message, okay, it's coming, it's coming. You make it personal. Personal perception of his return. Number two, purposeful preparation for the rapture. Purposeful. You prepare with a purpose that come what may, you will not miss the rapture, the coming of the Lord when he will come. Purposeful preparation for the rapture. Number three, pursuing proclamation of his righteousness. You're telling other people, you're declaring to other people, you're preaching to other people that they too should be ready, and they should abandon their sins and take the salvation of the Lord with his righteousness. Number one, personal perception of his return. In Matthew chapter 24, Reading from verse 38, Matthew 24, verse 38. For in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. Verse 39, and he knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. And then we're told in verse 40, it says, then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. That means every person must personally prepare and get ready for the coming of the Lord. Because two shall be together. Maybe they attend the same church. Maybe they attend the same house fellowship. Maybe they're in the same family. Maybe they're brothers of the same parents. Because the two are walking together in the field. One shall be taken and the other left. Verse 42. In verse 42, watch ye therefore personally, for ye know not what hour your Lord is. Your Lord is your Lord and is coming, and yet you have to watch. For ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. Luke chapter 17, verse 32. In Luke chapter 17, verse 32, remember Lot's wife. She was part of the family. She saw the angels with Lot and the two daughters. And she heard what Lot and the two daughters escaped to the mountain. Look not behind you. But you know, everyone should take that personal. It's not enough that husband and wife, they both claim to be saved, they both claim to see the vision of the Lord and they have the revelation of the Lord. It must be a personal perception of what the Lord has said about his coming again. Remember Lot's wife. Look at verse 33. In verse 33, whosoever shall seek to save his life shall lose it, and whosoever, this personal now, shall lose his life for his sake shall preserve it. Verse 34. In verse 34, I tell you, in that night there shall be two men in one bed, two people in one bed, the one shall be taken and the other shall be left. Matthew chapter 25, reading from verse 6. In Matthew 25, reading from verse 6, and at midnight, there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. You know the story. It's about the 12, it's about the five virgins, wise, five virgins, foolish. Verse 10. In verse 10, and while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready, this is the parable Jesus told, and he told us in the parable, it is necessary to evaluate yourself, to examine yourself, to make sure that you are ready. And it says, they that were ready, they went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Verse 11, afterward came also the other virgins saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. And then in verse 12, but he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. Then in verse 13, the conclusion, watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. We need personal preparation, personal perception, personal readiness, personal preparedness. 1 John chapter 3, reading from verse 2. In 1 John chapter 3 verse 2, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when we shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Verse 3, and every man, that becomes personal now, and every believer, and every child of God, and every man that has this hope in him, purifies himself, even as he is pure. Number two is the purposeful preparation for the rapture. Purposeful preparation, your purpose in your heart, your purpose in your life, your purpose at the time of prayer, and your purpose all through the day. Nothing will happen that will make you forget yourself and then miss the coming of the Lord. Purposeful preparation for the rapture. Hebrews chapter 9 verse 28. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him in your life, all through the day, whatever is happening, you're looking for the coming of the Lord, unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Philippians chapter 3 verse 14. In Philippians chapter 3 verse 14, it says, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. There are times you have to just buckle up yourself, or buckle up yourself, and say, I personally, whatever may be happening around you, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ. Why? Look at verse 20. In verse 20, for our conversation is in heaven, our expectation is in heaven, and our focus is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior. We're looking for him, the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 21, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body. It says, because of that expectation of his coming, that's why I press toward the mark of the high calling, according to the working whereby is able even to subdue all things unto himself. Colossians chapter 3 verse 2. In Colossians chapter 3, reading from verse 2, set your affection on things above. You're expecting the coming of the Lord. Set your affection on things above, your love on things above, and not on things on the earth. Look at verse 4. In verse 4, it tells us, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall he also appear with him in glory. It's because we know the Lord is coming, and the Lord is coming soon, and the Lord is coming unannounced, and we don't know the day or the time or the hour. That's why we set our affection on things above, so that when he comes, we will not be disappointed. Revelation chapter 3, we're reading from verse 3. Revelation chapter 3 verse 3, remember therefore how thou hast received and heard. Everything you have heard from the time you became born again, the faith that made you to be born again, the consecration that made you to be sanctified, the commitment that made you to have the witness of the Spirit in your heart, you're a child of God, all those things you have testified about, I'm a child of God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Look at verse 4. It says in verse 4, thou hast a few names even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments. They shall walk. They shall walk. Those who are walking with God now by the grace of God. Those who are walking with God now in godliness. The people who walk by grace and walk in godliness, they're the people that will walk into glory. That's why he says, you watch your garments that they are not defiled. They shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. And then in verse 5, it says in verse 5, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Look at verse 11. In verse 11 it says, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. We'll come to number 3 here. Number 3 is the persuasive proclamation, persuasive preaching of his righteousness. Because you know the Lord is coming, there are backsliders, you need to go and pursue them to return unto the Lord. There are sinners all around us, you need to go and appeal to them and plead with them and pray for them and do everything possible in your own conviction to make them turn unto the Lord. Persuasively you are proclaiming the word of God unto them, to reconcile them with God, to bring them into God's redemption, and to bring them into that righteousness of faith which will qualify them to go on that final day. Persuasive proclamation or preaching of his righteousness. It tells us in Malachi chapter 4 verse 5, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. He's coming, and then he says, before he comes, he'll send forth preachers that have the power and the spirit of Elijah to persuade the people to come to the Lord. And then in verse 6, he says, and he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. John the Baptist fulfilled that partially in his own time, and we are to fulfill that fully before the second coming of the Lord. Luke chapter 1, reading from verse 16. Luke chapter 1 verse 16, and many of the children of Israel shall return to the Lord their God. And then in verse 17, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just. We turn sinners to the Lord and they become forgiven, they become saved, and they're justified by faith. And then to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. That's our assignment now. That's our commission now. That's what the Lord wants us to concentrate on now, to prepare people for the coming of the Lord. He's giving us the ministry of reconciliation. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 is telling us, and all things of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. While we're waiting for the rapture, while we're waiting for the coming of the Lord, the ministry he has committed into our hands is the ministry of reconciliation. Reading from verse 19, it says, to wit, that is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Verse 20, it says, now then we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, we plead with you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. That's your ministry, that's my ministry, that's our preoccupation, and that is what we need to concentrate on until it comes. Be ye reconciled unto God. I pray you will do it. I will do it. I will do it. The Lord give you the grace to confirm your commitment in Jesus' name. And as we do, there's reward waiting for every one of us. Are you there? I said there's reward waiting for every one of us. Are you working so that you'll have a reward on that final day? I can't hear you. And I cannot see you. Daniel, don't stand up here. Daniel chapter 12, we're reading from verse 3. Daniel chapter 12, we're looking at verse 3. And they that be wise shall shine at the brightness of the firmament. Who are those who are wise? Like the wise virgins. They know the Lord is coming. They're certain the Lord is coming. And because of that, they know he will come suddenly. He'll come unannounced. They're getting ready. And they're doing everything they can do in their own personal lives to let your light so shine before men that they may see. And then they will glorify your Father who is in heaven. Not only that, they are turning other people to righteousness. And they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. I pray you'll be among the number in Jesus' name. Look at the past. If God, if Christ were to come at this minute, at this moment now, how much have you done for God? What are you going to be rewarded for? How many have you turned to righteousness in your own personal life? Are you ready with that holiness without which no man shall save the Lord? Are you ready for the coming of the Lord? And are you turning other people to righteousness? You need to tell the Lord that from now on, you'll have this priority. From now on, you'll have this readiness and preparedness. From now on, you will pursue the saving of souls and bringing them into the kingdom. Let's rise up now and take everything we have learned to the Lord in prayer. The Lord is coming. And because the Lord is coming, we need to understand, we need to apply this profound prophecy of the coming of the Lord. Perplexity is going to take place all over the earth, and there's going to be perversion and pollution that will spread all over the earth, and the people are preoccupied in pointless things. Where are you, and who are you, and how are you preparing for the coming of the Lord? Open your mouth and pray and say, Lord, I don't want to hear the word in vain. I don't want to be called a worker in vain. I don't want to hear this and then miss out on the final day. I want to be ready when the Lord will come. Tell the Lord he has all the grace, he has all the strength, and he wants you to be ready. He wants to prepare you. Why don't you say, Lord, whatever will hinder me, take it out of my way. I will be ready.